In today's video, we are going to discuss about some power and material saving machines which are going to make your survival lives a whole lot easier. So the first machine on our list is this catalytic cracking tower. Then next up, we are going to discuss about the deuterium extracting towers, and finally the new gas centrifuge and the new method to basically enrich uranium and make fuel out of it. So without any further ado, let's get straight into it. So we start this video with the catalytic cracking tower. Now the cracking tower can perform all the cracking recipes that the chemical plant can, and these recipes come in the following form: bitumen, industrial oil, then comes natural gas, diesel, and finally kerosene. Now these are all the products obtained from refining crude oil. But the thing is that the cracking tower won't consume any power like the chemical plant would. It only requires steam in order to process these materials into their more refined form. So let's take a look at all the different things that we can do with the cracking tower. In order to do anything, first things first, we need to provide it with steam, as that is the only requirement. And for that, you can use an electric boiler or a normal boiler. So a normal catalytic cracking tower, once crafted, will process bitumen by default. And by putting in bitumen and steam, you will get out crude oil and petroleum gas. Now this recipe is similar to the recipe which is processed in the chemical plant. So if we go to a chemical plant here and look at the bitumen cracking, then here the recipe is exactly the same. So once you start pumping bitumen inside the cracking tower, as you can see, it has started producing crude oil and petroleum gas, and it is not consuming any power whatsoever. Now let's take a look at the next cracking recipe, which is going to be our industrial oil cracking. Now industrial oil cracking in a chemical plant will only give you naphtha, but okay, yeah. Now if you want to change the fluid that the cracking tower basically processes, then just right click with the fluid identifier and it will change the type, and you can right click on any of the input or the output slots. So once I start pumping in industrial oil here, you will see that it not only gives us naphtha, but it also gives us petroleum gas along with it. Now that is the best thing about the catalytic cracking tower, that you are going to get tons and tons of petroleum gas, which is very useful for producing solid fuel and also other materials. So yeah, so next up we have the cracking for the gas, the natural gas, which is simply going to give us petroleum gas. And this recipe is similar in the chemical plant and also in the catalytic cracking tower. So once you start pumping in natural gas, the cracking tower will start producing petroleum out of it. The fourth recipe will be the diesel cracking, which will give you kerosene. This is by far the most important cracking recipe according to me. And the cracking tower will also give you kerosene, but petroleum gas along with it. So if I put in diesel here, then the diesel will be converted into kerosene and you will also get some petroleum gas with it. And the final cracking recipe is the kerosene cracking, which will give you petroleum gas. Now I don't know why you would do that, because kerosene is like an important rocket fuel, but yeah, the recipe is same for the catalytic cracking tower also. You put in kerosene and it will give you petroleum gas. So this was all about the catalytic cracking tower. Now let's take a look at the crafting recipe before we move further. 16 steel scaffolds, 4 big steel shells, 3 steel tanks, 4 polymer bars, 2 niobium ingots, and finally 12 clay catalysts will give you 1 cracking tower in the assembly machine. Now let's take a look at the deuterium extraction tower and the deuterium extractor basically. So before these towers were added, the only way to produce deuterium was in a chemical plant, and this method used sulfur and water to give you 500 millibuckets of deuterium. Now the only problem with this process was that sulfur is not renewable. Water is renewable, but sulfur is not. So you needed a constant supply of sulfur. Well, all this changes with the deuterium extractor and the deuterium extracting towers. What these machines do is basically they take water as their input and they take some power. And this water is then converted into heavy water. So if I start pumping water in this deuterium extractor, you will see that water is being consumed and this water is then being converted into heavy water. There. So let's take this heavy water input out first, so you can see the process of conversion. And any of its side can work as an input or an output, as there is no GUI on both of these machines. Now the only problem with deuterium extractor is that it uses a lot of power. As you can see, it ate right through the 1 million HE that we had stored in our storage cell. Now this is not the case with the deuterium extraction tower. I have also provided this tower with 1 million HE as I did with the deuterium extractor. And we are going to process the same amount of deuterium, or sorry, the same amount of water in this. But you will see that this tower works way faster. There is 24 buckets of water in this barrel, and it will process it in an instant, just like that. And all of that water has been converted into heavy water, while we barely used any power whatsoever. So if possible, always use the deuterium extraction tower instead of using the deuterium extractor. If this is a bug, I don't know that right now. But yeah, for some reason, the extraction tower uses less power than the extractor does. So it's always better to use it. Now once you have made some heavy water, you can start pumping this heavy water into the chemical plant, and the chemical plant will extract deuterium and liquid oxygen from it. Right now, all the heavy water is gone into the chemical plant, and this chemical plant will now convert it into deuterium and liquid oxygen. So that is how you can get deuterium with just energy and water. Now let's take a look at the new gas centrifuge and the new uranium enrichment method. So this is how the new gas centrifuge looks like. It has three sides for input where power and gas can go in, and behind it, it has one slot where it can output these gases. Now this is important because if you place another gas centrifuge directly adjacent to it, then the second gas centrifuge can now accept its input from the output of the first gas centrifuge. So now these two centrifuges can share their gases. If you place a third one, it can take its input from the second one, and so on and so forth. Now, let me give you guys an example for better understanding. This first gas centrifuge, the GUI is looking normal, but one thing that is different is that uranium hexafluoride now appears as natural uranium hexafluoride, which will be processed into low enriched uranium hexafluoride. So, if I now place down another gas centrifuge, it will detect that low enriched uranium hexafluoride is being pumped into it, and it will process it into medium uranium hexafluoride. The medium one will be then processed into high enriched uranium hexafluoride, and in the fourth one, the high enriched uranium hexafluoride will finally undergo complete isotopic separation. Now let's watch this entire process in action. Here I have a tank which is filled with uranium hexafluoride, and I am pumping it into this gas centrifuge. So let's start inputting the gas and watch it in action. So as you can see, the normal uranium hexafluoride was converted into low enriched uranium hexafluoride, and along with it, we also got a uranium-238 nugget. Now this process can be sped up using the speed upgrade if you want to. So yeah, that was the first level of uranium enrichment. Now if you place down another gas centrifuge and supply it with power, then it will take this low enriched uranium hexafluoride and convert it into medium enriched uranium hexafluoride. And another same thing is that it can basically accept upgrades. But the different thing is that along with uranium-238, we also got some nuggets of uranium fuel. So if you only want uranium fuel, then two levels of separation are good for you. But let's place down another one and start pumping it with power so that medium enriched uranium hexafluoride can be converted into high enriched uranium hexafluoride. Here we can see that it is being converted into high enriched uranium hexafluoride along with some uranium-238 ingots. And now if we place down our final gas centrifuge and supply it with power, then it will take this high enriched uranium hexafluoride, but it will only convert it with the gas centrifuge overclocking upgrade. You need it for total isotopic separation. So if obtaining nuclear fuel or uranium fuel is your only goal, then only two levels of gas centrifuge are enough for you. But if you want complete isotopic separation, that is if you want to convert your uranium hexafluoride with full efficiency, then place down four gas centrifuges with the overclocking upgrade in the last one, and it will give you uranium-238, uranium-235 and also some fluoride. And it will completely use up the uranium hexafluoride. So that is the max efficiency that you can get. I hope you guys liked this video. If you did, do smash that like button and also subscribe to the channel for more content like this.